was a 16-year-old boy who had quite the adventurous spirit. He loved to travel, explore new places, and learn about different cultures. On one of his travels, he stumbled upon a kingdom that was unlike any he had seen before. It was run completely by barefooted kids, no older than 10 years old. Jeremiah was fascinated by this and decided to stay for a while and observe the unique way this kingdom was run. As Jeremiah roamed around the kingdom, he couldn't help but feel a little out of place. The kids were all carefree and playful, while Jeremiah was used to the more serious and adult world. But he continued to explore and learn more about this kingdom. However, as time went on, Jeremiah started to get a little hungry. Being a curious and impulsive teenager, he decided to sneak into a store nearby and steal some snacks such as candy and chips. Little did he know, the young king of the kingdom, 8-year-old Miles, had seen him and called out to the other kids. Before Jeremiah knew it, he was surrounded and grabbed by multiple kids, who were all trying to take him to the dungeons. Jeremiah fought back, trying to resist and break free from the kids' grip. But they were too many and too strong for him. King Miles, who had a fierce and harsh personality, stepped on Jeremiah's face, forcing him to smell his feet while wearing a wicked grin on his face. Jeremiah was now completely restrained by the king and the other kids, who were all pressing down on him and preventing his hands and arms from moving. Finally, Jeremiah was dragged to the dungeons and thrown into a cell. He couldn't believe what had just happened. He had never been treated like this before. As days went by, Jeremiah was punished for various things, including disobeying King Miles or refusing to answer his questions. Each time, King Miles would force Jeremiah to smell his stinky, dirty bare feet, and the other kids would trample on Jeremiah's hands and fingers. Eventually, King Miles announced that Jeremiah would be his prisoner forever. He was never allowed to leave the castle, and whenever it was mealtime, the kids would force him to eat the bland and disgusting prison food. Jeremiah would often refuse, which would make King Miles order the other kids to pin down his hands while another kid forcefully fed him the food. At night, when Jeremiah was told to go to bed, he couldn't take it anymore. Desperate and feeling trapped, he pulled out a weapon, threatening to end his own life. The commotion caught the attention of the other kids, and King Miles came rushing in to see what was going on. Seeing Jeremiah in distress, he immediately went over to talk to him, trying to calm him down. At that moment, a kid named Flynn entered the room. He was 10 years old and seemed to have a more nurturing and caring attitude compared to the other kids. Flynn sensed the danger and quickly intervened, trying to restrain Jeremiah and take the weapon away from him. With the help of the other kids, they managed to pin down Jeremiah while Flynn successfully took the weapon away. Jeremiah couldn't move his hands as some of the kids were standing on them with their bare feet to keep them down. He couldn't move his arms as they were under the weight of some of the children. Some were using their hands, while others were using their feet to hold him down. Flynn, the leader of the group, kept pressing down on Jeremiah's chest, urging him to calm down. Jeremiah could not move his hands, which were trapped under the bare feet of the children. Some of them even used their hands and feet to hold down his arms, leaving him completely helpless. "Please, calm down," Flynn said, his voice shaking with fear. "We don't want to hurt you." Despite being outnumbered and physically overwhelmed, Jeremiah continued to struggle. But the more he struggled, the more the children tightened their grip on him. The struggle went on for some time as Jeremiah's mind was clouded with anger and confusion. He couldn't move his arms or legs, and his head was held down by one of the kids, King Miles, who was only 8 years old. Jeremiah tried to hit his head on the ground, but it was no use, as King Miles held it down too. Finally, exhausted and unable to break free, Jeremiah had no choice but to talk to the children. As Jeremiah lay there, with the weight of the other kids pressing him down, he couldn't help but cry. He felt so trapped and alone. But as he looked up, he saw Flynn smiling at him and asking if he liked lemonade. Despite the situation, Jeremiah couldn't help but laugh at the randomness of the question. He nodded, and to his surprise, one of the kids brought him a glass of lemonade. In that moment, Jeremiah realized that maybe not all kids in this kingdom were cruel. Flynn's act of kindness meant a lot to him. And just when he thought things couldn't get any better, King Miles came over and hugged him, telling him that everything will be okay. Later that day, King Miles ordered for Jeremiah to have a new room in the castle. He would no longer be staying in the dungeon, but he would still be considered King Miles' prisoner. A few hours later, Jeremiah was being taken to his new room, with Flynn and one of the other kids holding his hands while King Miles led the way. Jeremiah couldn't believe his eyes when he saw his new room. It was spacious and filled with toys and books. There was even a soft bed for him to sleep on. He turned to King Miles with tears in his eyes and thanked him for his generosity. As the night approached, King Miles informed Jeremiah that it was bedtime. But before tucking Jeremiah in, he asked if he wanted him to use his feet to put some blankets on him. Jeremiah had a weird look on his face, but Flynn and the other kids watched from the entrance with big smiles on their faces. King Miles used his feet to tuck in Jeremiah, and he couldn't stop giggling. After a long and tiresome day, Jeremiah found himself living in a castle with new friends who accepted him for who he was. He no longer felt alone or outcast, but instead, he felt like he belonged. However, the next morning, Jeremiah woke up to a strange pressure on his belly. As he opened his eyes, he saw King Miles standing on top of him, with his bare feet pressing down on Jeremiah's stomach. "Good morning, Jeremiah," King Miles chirped, completely unfazed by his morning routine. Flynn and some of the other kids were also in the room, watching Jeremiah closely, making sure he wasn't trying to hurt himself in his sleep. Jeremiah tried to get up, but King Miles didn't budge. Instead, he smiled at Jeremiah, his eyes glinting with mischief. "Don't try to escape, Jeremiah. You belong here," King Miles said, much to Jeremiah's bewilderment. Just as Jeremiah sometimes looked like he was getting annoyed, Flynn would put him in a headlock, with Jeremiah's head between his feet and legs. While King Miles would step on Jeremiah's hands and fingers. Some of the other kids joined in too, tickling Jeremiah for fun. Jeremiah tried his best to escape, but he couldn't match the strength and agility of the young kids. He struggled and squirmed, but it was all in vain. Flynn, Miles, and the other kids seemed to be enjoying themselves. Jeremiah struggled to break free, but Flynn's strong grip held him in place. Meanwhile, 8-year-old King Miles, the youngest ruler in the kingdom's history, stood on Jeremiah's hands and fingers, trying to restrain him. With a wicked grin, Miles taunted Jeremiah, "You can't escape now, Ja." A group of other children joined in, tickling Jeremiah's sides while he tried to squirm away. But with Miles' heavy weight on his hands and fingers, and Flynn's legs holding his head in place, he was helpless. Jeremiah's head was starting to feel squeezed and he begged, "Guys, come on. Let me go, this isn't fair." But the children just laughed and continued to play their game. Flynn playfully scolded Jeremiah, "Come on, stay still. You don't want to leave us with a good laugh, do you?" King Miles joined in, "Look, Jeremiah, at least my feet found someone to play with. It seems like your hands are having a lot of fun too." Jeremiah couldn't help but chuckle at the playful banter of his friends. Despite his struggles, he couldn't deny that he was having a good time with them.
Year-old boy who loved to dress up in funky outfits. He was always the life of the party, and Halloween was his favorite time of the year. This year, he had his heart set on dressing up as a clown. It was an unusual choice, especially since Halloween was still a few months away, but Dakota didn't care. He was excited to show off his amazing costume to his friends. As the days passed, Dakota's excitement grew as Halloween drew closer. However, to his dismay, he realized that Halloween was still months away. Dakota didn't want to wait that long to show off his costume. So, he made a bold decision to wear his clown outfit on Easter. It wasn't a common thing to do, but Dakota was a rebel, and he didn't care what people thought. On Easter morning, Dakota put on his funky clown outfit and headed out to the neighborhood in Rio de Janeiro where he was staying for a few weeks. As he walked down the alleyways, he received curious looks and stares from the locals. But Dakota didn't mind, he was getting used to the attention. However, his day took a turn for the worst when he came across a group of kids ranging from 9 to 12 years old. The kids were part of a local gang and were not the friendliest bunch. They took one look at Dakota and immediately started chasing him, shouting and screaming in Portuguese. Dakota couldn't understand a word they were saying, but their mean looks and aggressive behavior were enough to make him realize that they were not playing a game. Dakota's heart was racing as he picked up his pace, trying to outrun the group of kids. But they were fast, faster than he had expected. Dakota knew he had to think fast and find a way to escape. As he turned a corner, he stumbled and fell to the ground. The kids surrounded him, trying to stomp on him with their feet. Dakota was scared, but he couldn't let them harm him. With all his cleverness and agility, he managed to grab one of the kid's legs and pushed him away. Then, with a swift punch and push, he got away from the kids and started running again. Dakota's heart was pounding, and his breath was labored as he continued to run through the streets of Rio de Janeiro. He wasn't familiar with this place, and he didn't know where he was going. But he had to keep moving. He couldn't let those kids catch him. As he ran, he realized that he didn't know the local language, and that made him feel even more lost and scared. Dakota wished he was back in his hometown of Muncie, Indiana, where everyone spoke English, and he felt safe and at home. But he knew he couldn't dwell on that thought now. He had to find a way out of this situation. With quick thinking and some luck, Dakota managed to lose the kids and find his way back to his neighborhood. He was relieved and exhausted, but he knew he couldn't let his guard down. He had to be careful, as those kids could still be out there somewhere, waiting for their next victim. Dakota was starting to feel kind of happy thinking he had escaped those kids. However, his joy was short-lived when he took a wrong turn and found himself in a dead-end alley. As he tried to turn back, he noticed a group of kids, ranging from 9 to 12 years old, approaching him. They were part of a gang known for causing trouble in the neighborhood. Dakota knew he was in trouble. He had heard of this gang and their reputation for causing chaos. But he didn't let fear consume him. He stood his ground, ready to fight if needed. "You shouldn't have come down this alley, clown boy," sneered one of the kids. Dakota clenched his fists and prepared for a fight. The kids circled around him, taunting and jeering. But Dakota didn't let their words get to him. He knew he had to stay calm and focused. As one of the kids made a move to attack him, Dakota quickly dodged and gave him a powerful punch in the gut. The other kids were caught off guard, not expecting Dakota to fight back. But he wasn't about to let them kidnap him or harm him in any way. Dakota's punches were quick and strong, but they outnumbered him. He took down a few more of the kids, but soon found himself outnumbered and overpowered. They managed to get a few hits in, and Dakota fell to the ground, gasping for air. The kids, now emboldened by their success, surrounded him, kicking and punching him relentlessly. They were cruelly enjoying the thrill of beating up someone weaker than them. As Dakota was struggling to fight them off, he suddenly remembered his strong legs. He had always been a good sprinter and had built powerful leg muscles from all the running he did. With a swift kick, he managed to push a few of the kids away, giving him some space to get back on his feet. But just as he was about to stand up, one of the kids tackled him, trapping his face under his weight. Dakota tried to push him off, but the kid was too heavy. Dakota could feel his breath getting short as he struggled to breathe. But he refused to give up. With all his strength, he managed to push the kid off and quickly got back on his feet. "You guys won't defeat me that easily," Dakota yelled, his voice filled with determination. But the kids were not done yet. They could see that Dakota was getting tired, and they were eager to take advantage of the situation. They swarmed him again, trying to pin him down. Dakota fought back with all his might, throwing punches and kicks left and right. It was a chaotic and intense fight, and Dakota was starting to feel exhausted. But he refused to back down. He knew he had to protect himself and prove to these kids that he wasn't an easy target. After what felt like hours, but was only a few minutes, Dakota somehow managed to throw off all the kids. He quickly ran out of the alley. Dakota was being chased again, but somehow lost those kids then out of nowhere. One of the kids suddenly grabbed Dakota's arm, making him stop in his tracks. Dakota tried to pull away, but the kid's grip was too strong. He started to feel scared, not knowing what these kids were going to do to him. "What do you want?" Dakota asked, trying to sound confident. "We want to teach you a lesson, clown," another kid said, stepping closer to Dakota. Dakota's heart was racing, and his mind went blank. He didn't know what to do, and he couldn't move his legs as they suddenly started to feel sore. He knew it was because of all the walking he had done in his heavy clown shoes. The gang saw that Dakota couldn't move, and they started to take advantage of the situation. They pushed him around, making him fall to the ground. They were about to drag him away when suddenly, they heard a loud commotion coming from a nearby alley. Curious, the gang went to check it out, leaving Dakota alone on the ground. He was relieved but also worried about what was happening in the alley. Knowing that he couldn't just leave without making sure everything was all right, Dakota mustered up the courage to stand up and walk towards the alley. As he turned the corner, he saw a group of kids around the same age as the gang, but they were dressed differently. Instead of street clothes, they were wearing traditional Japanese attire. Dakota was amazed, but he was also glad to see that these kids seemed to be in control of the situation. They were standing in front of the gang, and one of them was speaking in a firm tone. Dakota listened in and found out that these kids were from a rival gang. They were determined to protect their territory and not let the other gang take control. The situation was tense, and Dakota didn't know what to do. Suddenly, he saw his chance to escape, but he couldn't bring himself to leave without thanking the Japanese gang for saving him. "Thank you for saving me," Dakota said, approaching the group. The Japanese gang turned to look at him, surprised to see a kid in a clown outfit talking to them. "Don't worry, little one. We will take care of these troublemakers," the leader of the Japanese gang said, giving Dakota a reassuring smile. Dakota was relieved and grateful. He couldn't believe that he had been saved by a group of kids who were only a few years younger than him. As he watched from a distance, the two gangs started to fight, but it was clear that the Japanese gang was stronger and more organized. In the end, the other gang ran away, and the Japanese gang was victorious. Dakota was in awe of their bravery and strength. He thanked them again before heading back home. As he walked, Dakota couldn't help but think about the two gangs and how different they were. One used their power to intimidate and hurt others, while the other used their power to protect and defend. He realized that it didn't matter how old or what you wore. What mattered was the choices you made and the actions you took. From that day on, Dakota had a newfound respect for the Japanese gang and their code of honor. He also learned that Halloween wasn't just about dressing up and getting candy. It was about being brave and standing up for what is right. And even though it wasn't a traditional Halloween, it was a night that Dakota would never forget. Later, Dakota decided to go home since it was starting to get late, and he didn't know how long it would stay peaceful for, since he has heard of many drug wars happening not far from the neighborhood. He was in right now. So Dakota went back home. Dakota may have missed some things about the US, but there were some things he liked about Brazil too. When he came over to Brazil, he didn't feel like moving from one country to another game. Next morning, Dakota woke up getting ready to go see downtown Rio de Janeiro with his buddy Diego, who was 19 years old. They were going to hit the streets of downtown Rio and go sightseeing and shopping. Dakota quickly jumped out of bed and got ready, eager to start the day. He put on his favorite casual street clothes, a loose t-shirt, and a pair of comfy shorts, instead of his usual funky outfits. He wanted to blend in with the locals and enjoy the experience fully. His parents were a little surprised to see him dressed in such plain clothes, but they didn't say anything. They knew how much Dakota admired his older buddy and how much he wanted to impress him. When Diego arrived, Dakota was all set to go. They hopped on Diego's motorbike, and he revved up the engine, ready for an adventure. Diego was like a big kid, and he loved showing Dakota new places and things. They zoomed through the busy streets of Rio, with the wind whipping through their hair, making them feel alive. Their first stop was at a famous cathedral in the heart of Rio. Dakota was awestruck by its grandeur and beauty. Diego explained the history behind the cathedral and its significance to the locals. They spent some time exploring the cathedral and taking pictures before heading to their next destination. Next on their itinerary was a popular street market, known for its unique and handmade items. Diego was an expert at bargaining, and he taught Dakota some useful tips to get a good deal. They both ended up buying some souvenirs and gifts for their families. Diego also treated Dakota to some traditional Brazilian street food, which he had been craving for a long time. As they walked around the market, Dakota noticed the stark contrast between the rich and the poor. There were people living in shanties on one side of the street, while luxury condominiums were on the other side. Diego explained to him the harsh reality of life in Rio and how the city was struggling to bridge the gap between the social classes. Their next stop was a famous viewpoint overlooking the entire city. Diego had been there before, but it was Dakota's first time, and he was blown away by the breathtaking view. They sat there for a while, taking in the beauty and enjoying the peace and quiet away from the noise of the city. Diego shared some of his wisdom and life lessons with Dakota, leaving a lasting impression on the young boy. As they headed back down, Diego suggested going to a nearby shopping mall. It was still early in the day, and they had some time to kill before heading back home. Dakota was hesitant at first, knowing how expensive it could be, but Diego convinced him to come along, promising to keep it within a budget. Inside the mall, Diego took Dakota to all the popular stores and showed him the latest fashion trends. Diego was a fashion enthusiast, and Dakota learned a lot about style and grooming from him. He picked out some stylish outfits for Dakota, insisting that he try them on. Dakota was amazed at how different he looked and felt in those clothes. He had never thought he could pull off a cool and trendy look like this. As they walked out of the mall with their shopping bags, Dakota felt grateful to have a friend like Diego. He had shown him a whole new side of Rio and opened his eyes to different cultures and ways of life. They headed back home, exhausted but content, with fond memories of the day etched in their minds. That night, as Dakota lay in bed, he couldn't help but think about how much his life had changed since he met Diego. From a shy and introverted boy, he had grown into a more confident and outgoing person. He realized that true friendship knows no age or boundaries, and he was thankful to have a mentor and friend like Diego, who had not only shown him a fun day out, but had also taught him valuable lessons about life. Dakota and Diego started watching a little bit of TV when they got home. They both had gotten a little bit hungry, but as they were about to grab some snacks from the kitchen, they heard a loud knocking at the door. Confused, they both walked towards the door and opened it to reveal a young boy, no more than 11 years old, with a badge pinned to his shirt. Before they could ask him what he wanted, he introduced himself as Officer Miguel. Dakota and Diego exchanged a puzzled look, wondering why there was a young boy at their doorstep claiming to be a police officer. As they were about to question him, Miguel explained that in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, where they live, they had recently passed a law allowing kids to start working and having more rights. This included working as police officers. Dakota was fascinated by this concept, as he had never heard of kids being cops before. He couldn't help but ask Miguel more questions about it. Diego, on the other hand, seemed a bit skeptical about the idea. Miguel went on to explain how kids were now allowed to own property, get paid for their work, and even have certain jobs that were previously reserved for adults. He also mentioned that they were trained to handle any situation and were just as capable as their adult counterparts. Dakota found this whole idea very interesting and was amazed at how much things had changed in just a few months. He was also impressed by Miguel's confidence and professionalism despite his age. Diego, however, still had some reservations about the idea of kids being cops. Before they could discuss it any further, a group of young cops, ranging from 7 to 16 years old, showed up at their doorstep. They were all wearing similar uniforms and had a serious look on their faces. Dakota and Diego couldn't help but feel a little intimidated by their presence. Miguel explained that they were there for a reason, and that reason became clear when they handcuffed Diego and informed him that he was being arrested for not paying his taxes. Dakota was shocked and angry. He never imagined that his friend could be arrested for something like this. he started yelling at the cops, questioning their authority, and accusing them of being too young to make such decisions. The situation quickly escalated, with Dakota raising his voice and the cops trying to calm him down. One of the cops, a 14-year-old boy, stepped forward and told Dakota that he needed to calm down and listen to what they had to say. He introduced himself as Officer Alex and asked Dakota to sit down inside the house so they could talk. Dakota, still frustrated and confused, followed the instructions and sat down on the couch with Alex. Alex patiently explained to him that the law allowed kids to work and earn money, but it also came with certain responsibilities, like paying taxes. He further explained that Diego had been avoiding paying his taxes for a while now, and despite several warnings, he had failed to comply. The young cops had been assigned to patrol the neighborhood and make sure everyone was following the law. Dakota listened intently, trying to understand the situation. He still couldn't believe that his friend was being taken away by such young officers. He looked around and noticed that Miguel was also being escorted away, as he had been the one to report Diego's non-payment of taxes. Alex went on to explain that everyone, regardless of their age, had to follow the law and face the consequences if they didn't. He also assured Dakota that Diego would be treated fairly and that he would have a chance to pay his taxes and be released. Feeling a mix of emotions, Dakota sat quietly for a few moments, processing everything that had just happened. He realized that this new law may have its advantages, but it also had consequences that he wasn't fully aware of. As the cops prepared to leave, Alex handed Dakota a flyer with information about how kids could start working, earn money, and also pay their taxes. He also mentioned that they were welcome to join the police force once they turned 16 and underwent training. Dakota watched as his friend and Officer Miguel were driven away in a police car. He couldn't believe how much his day had changed in just a few short hours. He also couldn't help but wonder about his own future and what opportunities this new law could bring for him and his friends. As he sat there pondering, he realized that even though he was still a 14-year-old boy, this new law gave him and other kids the chance to have a voice and be a part of making a change in their community. He made a mental note to do some research and understand more about this law and its implications. From that day on, Dakota's perspective towards kids being cops changed. He started to understand the importance of having young minds involved in decision making and how it could bring positive changes to society. He also gained a newfound respect for his young buddy, Diego, who stood for what he believed in and paid the price for it. Dakota sat in his room, the afternoon sun streaming through his window. He turned the pages of the newspaper, his eyes glued to the headlines. It was filled with stories of crime, violence, and poverty in the slums of Rio de Janeiro. The pictures were haunting, the words chilling. He was only 14, but he already had a strong sense of justice and a desire to help those in need. He often volunteered at the local homeless shelter and worked part-time at a community center. His parents had instilled in him the values of compassion and empathy, and he took them to heart. As he read on about the dire situation in Rio's slums, a knock on his door interrupted his thoughts. Dakota got up and opened the door to find a man standing there. He was wearing a dirty shirt, ripped jeans, and had a scruffy beard. "Can I help you?" Dakota asked, trying to be polite. The man held out a small bag, his hand shaking a little. "You want you buy? Good stuff, good price," he said, barely looking at Dakota. It didn't take long for Dakota to realize that the man was trying to sell him drugs. He shook his head, "No, thank you. I'm full from eating earlier," he joked, trying to defuse the situation. The man's face fell, and he muttered something in Portuguese before turning to leave. Dakota couldn't help but feel a pang of guilt in his chest. He knew that this man was most likely trying to make a living in any way he could, and selling drugs was probably his last resort. But Dakota also knew that drugs were dangerous and could ruin lives. Closing his door, Dakota sat back at his desk, his mind still on the man and the slums in Rio. He couldn't help but feel a sense of responsibility to do something, even if it was just a small act of kindness. He grabbed his laptop and started to do some research on how he could make a difference. That's when he came across an organization that was working to provide education and resources for children in the slums of Rio.